The next item on the order paper is a motion on the failure of the Executive. The Business Committee has agreed to allow up to 2 hours for this debate. The proposer of the motion will have 10 minutes to propose and 10 minutes to wind. One amendment has been selected and is published on the marshal list. The proposer of the amendment will have 10 minutes to propose the amendment and 5 minutes to wind. All other speakers will have 5 minutes. I call the clerk to read the motion.
That this assembly recognises the grave consequences for the people of Northern Ireland of the failure of the Executive to agree a budget and estimates for the financial year 2017-18, the failure of the Executive to endorse a programme for government, and the continuing failure of the Executive to safeguard the interests of the people of Northern Ireland following the result of the EU referendum.
Thank you, and I call Mr. Mike Nesbitt to move the motion.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Once upon a time, there was a young boy who was put into an institutional home, not because he had done anything wrong, but his mother was not married, and in those days that was deemed a problem. His problem was that in this institution, those who had been charged to nurture him, to love him and to care for him, abused him physically, mentally, psychologically. And as he looked around him, there were other boys and girls being abused. And as he grew older, he realized there were many other institutional homes where this was happening. And successive governments ignored him. And then an executive came along who said, "We understand. I tell you what we'll do for you. We will find a judge and we will ask him to conduct an inquiry." And that judge is Sir Anthony Hart. And in 3 days' time, on Friday, he will tell those victims what he thinks and what he is recommending. But the report rests in the Executive Office. And to all extents and purposes, the Executive Office is shut. And the people who populate Stormont Castle and run our Executive, who say they stand up for the vulnerable and the needy, have put their own interests first, because nobody can action whatever it is that Sir Anthony Hart has recommended and will tell the victims and survivors of historical institutional abuse he has recommended when he meets them in South Belfast on Friday. Another scenario. An 18-year-old finishes her first week at work, lifts her little brown envelope with her pay packet, and meets a friend for a drink. Unfortunately, she chooses the same bar as the IRA bomber. And as a consequence, her friend is killed, and she spends the rest of her life in a wheelchair, unable to work, unable to earn, unable to save or contribute to national insurance for her pension. And against all odds, she lives to a pensionable age. And now she is asking, as a couple of hundred others are, "Can I have a special pension because I have been injured and denied life opportunities through no fault of my own?" And the answer from this executive has been no. You may not have a special pension, because if you're having a pension, we want one for the bomber. Because the next time that bomber went out to plant a bomb, it went off prematurely and he got injured. And perversely, they argue, so he is the same as you. But again, it is these two big parties who say they stand up strong for the vulnerable and for the needy in our society. Your colleagues would not give in the last debate when I asked for an intervention, so don't expect to take during this debate, Mr. Stalford. No, reap what you sow, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Stalford must reap what he and his colleagues sow. Last Monday, as the implosion began and the Deputy First Minister resigned, and we saw final proof that after 10 long years, the DUP and Sinn Féin are incapable of sharing power in Stormont Castle. On that very day, what was the Prime Minister doing? Mrs. May was announcing her determination to tackle mental health and wellbeing issues in England and Wales. That's what we need. Per head of population, our mental health and wellbeing issues are possibly the worst in the world, partly because, to some extent, it is a legacy issue. I've campaigned on it since the day and hour I got this position. And maybe we've raised the profile, and maybe we have something near to agreement that it is a problem we have to tackle, but have we tackled it? No, we haven't. So thousands of our citizens woke up this morning denied a sense of purpose in life, not because they don't want it, not because they don't want to work, but because we are not helping them. And it lies at the feet of the parties, of the executive. It lies at Stormont Castle, where for 10 years those two parties have failed to find a way to do business together. £85,000 a day being wasted. What would the victims of institutional abuse do with that money? What would the victims of the Troubles do? How could that help those suffering poor mental health and well-being? It's not an orange issue. It's not a green issue. It's an issue of right and wrong, of competence and of incompetence. And yet, when you raise that issue in this chamber, when you suggest there is such a concept as ministerial responsibility, some parties now make that synonymous with hate crime and misogyny. How desperate, how embarrassing for the integrity of these institutions. As we go into an election, Mrs. May is preparing to trigger Article 50. And Northern Ireland remains the most affected region of the United Kingdom by our impending withdrawal from the European Union, and we remain the least prepared. Mr. Speaker, here is the executive's plan for Brexit. It is a blank sheet. There are no thoughts. There are no actions. There has been no identification of the policy options, no determination of what our priorities are, and no determination whether our priorities complement or conflict with the UK governments. And where they conflict, and they will conflict on occasions, we have a huge problem. The parties of the executive have failed the people. And it came to a head again yesterday, Mr. Speaker, when you had to vacate the chair because you were the subject of a debate. And of course, the DUP deployed a petition of concern. And that kind of sums it up in terms of how Sinn Féin and the DUP have run government for the last 10 years. Protect the individuals, protect the parties, never mind the country. This is 10 years of failure, of scandals, of debacles, of disappointments. I hope the people have had enough. I hope the people say, on the 2nd of March, we will look to parties who want to put the country first, ahead of the party and ahead of the individuals within that party. The Ulster Unionist Party stand ready to do that. We stand ready for change. Let us come back after the 2nd of March and put the country first and put the people first. Let's forget the rhetoric about standing strong for the vulnerable and the weak in our society. The victims of the Troubles, the victims of historical institutional abuse, are not so much vulnerable today as angry today, as the people of this country are angry, justifiably, at the incompetence and the failure of the DUP and Sinn Féin over 10 long, useless years in Stormont Castle.
I call Dr. Stephen Farry to move the amendment.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I move to support the motion and also to move the amendment. And I will come to the specifics of the amendment shortly, and hopefully it does add a specific example and a very pertinent example to the broad thrust of the motion. But the motion is around the failure of the executive. And exploring that, we have to first of all look backwards, but in doing so to recognise that power sharing and devolution are important concepts for Northern Ireland. They're something we should value and cherish. They are about providing a forum, first of all, in which we can actually have reconciliation and bring the different traditions in Northern Ireland together in terms of government. That is a very particular aspect of our situation in Northern Ireland, but more generally, and if we look across what's happening in Scotland and Wales, we see that devolution is the norm within these islands, and Northern Ireland should be no different in that particular regard. Now, power sharing and devolution can work, but we have to recognise that so far it hasn't been working, particularly under the stewardship of the DUP and Sinn Féin. Ultimately, for power sharing to work, it's more than simply the right institutional design, and we can for sure make improvements in that regard, but ultimately it has to be based upon trust, partnership and mutual respect, and most clearly we do not have that whatsoever. We have had instead dysfunction, which has been characterised by bickering, political instability. Ultimately, the situation today with institutions are seriously imperiled. Missed opportunities in terms of things we could have been doing to improve the lives of people. Deadlock on a whole host of key issues, as manifested through mutual vetoes and the use of petition of concern, and particularly over the past number of months, increased problems around accountability, lack of transparency, and indeed corruption and cronyism. You almost have the impression at times that devolution under the current model is about carve up and spoils for particular communities, rather than actually working in a coherent, cohesive way on behalf of the community as a whole. Looking at our situation today, however, we're meeting in the context of, first of all, what is now going to be missed opportunities to put Northern Ireland forward. An opportunity delayed may well be an opportunity missed. At a strategic level, we're not now going to have, for quite some time, a programme for government, an economic strategy, a social strategy, an investment strategy, and a budget. Five key strategic documents that you would expect any meaningful government to have. And that's before you even think through each of the individual departments and all of the various strategies and initiatives that will now go on hold in that regard. While ministers do remain in office until the election, there is, seems a slight misunderstanding, particularly whenever we hear the Health Minister talk about, well, I'm going to be making announcements right through at my desk, right through to the election. That may well be the case, but there are rules in terms of the PIRDA arrangements as to what can and cannot be done in the election campaign, and I'm not sure the penny has actually dropped in that particular regard.
Yep. Would you agree with me that the Health Minister's comments are pretty pointless in that no budget has been set for next year, and that's the fundamental job of any government, and in that, both DUP and Sinn Féin have failed.
Indeed, and I'll come to this in a moment, but the implications of not having a budget across the public services will be most acute in terms of the area of health, where we were expecting the most significant amount of change if things had been done correctly in this regard. Mr Nesbitt has already made the point in relation to Brexit, no particularly labour that point, but there is an irony today that we are meeting in the dog days of this Assembly. In the context where we've had a major speech from the UK Prime Minister, where, as has been stated, we don't have any meaningful plan from our own executive. It is worth noting that our counterparts in both Scotland and Wales are meeting today to discuss the UK Prime Minister's statement and to advance how they plan to mitigate the impact upon their respective jurisdictions. But there's an even more immediate issue that we have to look to, which is beyond the things that we could be doing in terms of the opportunities, which is that issue of actually keeping the lights on. We normally have a situation where elections are planned. We move into elections in a reasonably organised way. There's an orderly wind down in business. And if we throw our minds back to this time last year, or a few months ahead of us, where we were rushing through a whole host of legislation because people were conscious that there was going to be a break in the Assembly. We didn't want to lose a lot of the work that had been built up through departments. It may have been done in a bit more organised way than it was, but nonetheless, people were recognising the fact that there was a need to get these things over the line. We had to make sure, for example, that the budget was passed as well, and budget legislation was moving through the Assembly accordingly. In terms of what's now before us as a political crisis, we're essentially pushing governance over a cliff edge. That would be bad in any context, but it is particularly bad in the context of where we are in terms of the budget cycle itself. And I have to say that there is a lot of complacency coming across from those who were formerly in charge around how we can make do over the next number of weeks in this regard, and indeed, I have to say, from the UK Government. Reference has been made to the fact that we can look to the Northern Ireland Act, Section 59, and there is the potential for the Permanent Secretary to strike a budget 3 days before the end of the financial year. So we're all going to be magically saved, and departments have a wee bit of cash, and things can roll on until we get our act together. This works on the assumption that departments will function essentially from a standing start. That is not how things work in the real world. In reality, there has to be a lead-in process to this. Normally, we would be setting our budget, or the executive agreeing a budget statement, which sets out the full amounts of what should be there during the course of the full financial year. Indeed, some people would argue we should be seeing a 3-year budget rather than a 1-year budget, so we can have some proper strategic planning. But instead, we have nothing. And then flowing from that, we have the first budget bill and then the second budget bill, which gives the legislative authority for departments to spend money in that particular regard. So most departments would have information about their budget for the incoming financial year months in advance. They can then make their own internal allocations. They can think carefully how to make the best use of their resources and indicate to arm's length bodies, and in particular the community voluntary sector, what budget that they're going to be having. And that way, things can be done as efficiently and effectively as possible. In the context of a declining budget as well, it's incumbent on us all to make sure every penny is used to the best advantage. So we're going to see instead a situation where people are going to be placed on protective notice, particularly where organisations do not have certainty in terms of their budget and there's not an existing contractual relationship from government. We're going to see a situation where cuts will have to be made because accounting officers are going to be very loath to make any new discretionary spending commitments without certainty as to what their budget is going to be in the context of the position in July, whether it's going to be a 100% budget or a 95% budget. And even if we strike a 100% budget sometime in July, the next financial year is still going to be a train wreck because we have not taken a strategic approach to the budget, so things will be going missing in that regard. So important decision making that should be happening at this point in time around, for example, the health service is not going to be taken forward. My colleague Paula Bradshaw will focus on that in particular detail, but there are many other examples across government as well. Now, the reason we have highlighted the amendment around the regional rate It's important that we focus on a particular aspect of how the legislation is framed. We have a situation where the ability of the Permanent Secretary of DFP to set a budget only relates to the consolidated fund, i.e. the block grant. It doesn't relate to what are termed in the legislation accruing resources, which means other income that comes into government coffers. Now, there may be some ambiguity around some aspects of this, but aspects such as the regional rate do not count as part of what is in the purview of the Permanent Secretary of the DFP. Now, again, people are talking about, well, we can defer the raising of the rates until as far as June or July, and let's not worry about that there, so we can catch up with ourselves and everything will be fine. But we will have a situation where district councils are uncertain of exactly what's going to be coming their way. We will see a situation where there will be additional administrative costs in terms of land and property service actually trying to implement this, and we will see a situation where we have greater levels of default in terms of people paying what is their rates payments, and that default could amount to many tens of millions if not more. So what we're talking about here is not something on the margins, not something that we can gently finesse. These are all things that have major financial consequences for Northern Ireland, and they're not numbers on a piece of paper. A reference to resources that make a difference for people's lives, that allow us to improve the social and economic well-being of this society and to improve the stock of all of our people. So the consequences of us driving government over, or seeing government being driven over a cliff edge by the Sinn Féin and the DUP, I mean, let's not argue about who exactly is to blame for it. The fact is government is going over a cliff edge because of collective failure of those in the positions of authority. We are going to see real pain for the people of Northern Ireland over the coming months. Thank you.
Members, the Business Committee has agreed to meet at 1 p.m. today. I propose, therefore, by leave of the Assembly, to suspend the sitting until 2 p.m. The first item of business when we return will be question time. The sitting is by leave suspended.
Members, we now return to the debate on the failure of the executive. I call Mr. Christopher Stulford, and the member will have 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Mr. Deputy Speaker, Northern Ireland is, I believe, a better place than it was 10 years ago. I think that we can be proud of the fact that our country is more at peace with itself than it was 10 years ago. I think we can be proud of the investment that has been made in jobs and in local services and improving public services. I listened to the self-serving contribution from Mr. Nesbitt earlier in this debate. Who could believe from his contribution, who could believe that his party presided over a situation where some of the worst terrorist murderers in the history of this country. I see he sighs. I think it's unfortunate that you don't like to be reminded of the record of your party, that some of the worst terrorist murderers in the history of Northern Ireland, including people like Sean Kelly, who bombed the Shankill Road, were released from prison without the decommissioning of IRA weaponry, without even a commitment to support policing and the rule of law. When you mount your high horse and point your finger at others, sir, you should recall that there are three pointing back at you. And any unionist who knows the record of the way in which the Ulster Unionist Party behaved will not be lectured in terms of our approach to dealing with Republicans. I believe that Northern Ireland is a better place. I believe that it is in the interests of the people of Northern Ireland that we have devolved institutions to work for the people. And when I hear the criticism that was levelled by Mr. Nesbitt, 10 long years, he seems to forget that for 9.5 of those long years, his party was a party in government. So when you mount to your high horse and lecture about 10 long years of failed devolution, for 9.5 of those 10 years, for 95% of the time, if it was a failure, sir, your party was party to it. I believe that all parties can look back over the last 10 years, whether it's the SDLP, the Ulster Unionists, the DUP, the Alliance Party or Sinn Féin, and can each, on an individual level and on a collective level, point to achievements that were made during that period of time. They can point to positive steps that were taken by all the parties in terms of improving the life of the people of Northern Ireland. And that is where I believe in devolution. That's the value of devolution. The value of devolution lies in using those tools to improve the lot of our constituents. And that's why I was in for the question from Michelle, for Michelle O'Neill. And I have to say, listening to the Minister describing the plans that she has for health and social care in Northern Ireland and how we're going to move forward, I find myself wondering, what planet is she on? Because we all know that where we're heading now is probably elections to talks, no devolution, and Mr. Eastwood said this yesterday in the House, elections to talks, probably no devolution. And that means direct rule ministers making the decisions concerning Northern Ireland. I don't want that any more than any other person does. Even people who I disagreed with on the European referendum question, I don't want a Tory government making the decisions for my constituents any more than members of the SDLP or other parties do, because I don't trust them to act in the best interests of my constituents any more than you do. I think it's profoundly sad that it has come to this, but I think we need to be honest. The reason why we're at this point is because one party, Sinn Féin, did not like the outcome of the election, and they saw in RHI an opportunity to have a rerun. They haven't been talking about They haven't been talking about RHI. They've been listing various nationalist and republican totems in the run into the election, and we will face them on those issues, and we will prevail in the election.
Nishiram, sir, Colm Eastwood. I call Colm Eastwood.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, we're here to talk about the failure of the executive, and all you have to do is look around. I don't even need to make a speech to illustrate the failure of this executive, but I'll give it a go. It is utterly surreal what's going on in this building today. The oxygen has been dragged out of this place, and the public are just bemused. And people keep talking about the anger out on the streets. People aren't angry, Mr. Deputy Speaker. They're utterly furious that we have got to this point. And some of us went to an election last year and said that we would go to a programme for government negotiation after the election, as was outlined in the so-called Fresh Start Agreement. I went into those negotiations. We did our homework. We had papers written. We put the papers in on all manner of subjects and topics and areas, and nobody wanted to negotiate back. Nobody wanted to talk to us about how we can invest in the Irish language, how we can protect equality for LGBT people, how we can tackle poverty and discrimination right across our society. Nobody wanted to talk to us about how we can expand opportunities for students and develop our economy and build our infrastructure. Nobody wanted to talk back. It reminds me a bit like today, when there's nobody here. People who are well paid to be here aren't here. They talk about meaningless discussions. Well, it's not meaningless to the people out on the street. They can go and put their posters up today if they want. Some of us are here to do business, and we'll be here until the very, very end. It is, of course, true that because of the DUP's despicable and disgraceful behaviour, around not just our RHI, that we've got to this point. But it's also true, Mr. Deputy Speaker, that they were let do all those things. They were allowed to do all those things. It's not 3 or 4 weeks ago where a draft programme for government was announced and hailed by Sinn Féin and the DUP. No Irish Language Act, no anti-poverty strategy, no LGBT rights legislation, none of that. None of it. And we were all called whingers and opposition for opposition's sake for pointing it out. Now, all of a sudden, it's stuff they just couldn't stand for. We're calling time on the DUP status quo. But when did it become the DUP status quo? Because only a few weeks before that, we were told that this is what delivery looks like. Well, it looks pretty bare today, Mr. Deputy Speaker. We're faced today with the biggest economic, social and political crisis to face these islands since partition. We have a Tory government who are determined to bring about a hard Brexit. A hard Brexit which would destroy everything that we've built, everything that's left of it. It would destroy our economy, destroy our Good Friday Agreement, destroy everything that we have. And Theresa May said a lot of things today, but what she did say, she's got a paper from the Scottish Government, a paper coming from the Welsh Government. She didn't mention anything coming from this executive. Nothing at all. 7 months and nothing at all from our executive. And people can go to the microphone, the Falls Road, and complain about Theresa May's speech today. They didn't even put anything on paper to the British Prime Minister or the British Government to tell them that we need to protect our citizens here, our citizens who voted 56% to remain as part of the European Union. Mr. Deputy Speaker, tomorrow marks an important day for a man called John Hume. It's his 80th birthday. Someone who built these institutions, who democratically struggled to ensure that we could have these institutions and that we could be part of an open Europe. In his Nobel Peace Prize speech, he said, "I want to see Ireland, North and South, the wounds of violence healed, play its rightful role in a Europe that will, for all Irish people, be a shared bond of patriotism and new endeavour. I want to see an Ireland as an example to men and women everywhere of what can be achieved by living for ideals rather than fighting for them, and by viewing each and every person as worthy of respect and honour. I want to see an Ireland of partnership where we wage war on poverty and want, where we reach out to the marginalised and dispossessed, where we build together a future that can be as great as our dreams allow." If people still believe in that, Mr. Deputy Speaker, they have an opportunity on the 2nd of March to give voice to that and to put an end to this nonsense that we've had for the last 10 years. Thank you.
I call Pam Cameron.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. And given the events of yesterday, should anyone actually be listening to this debate today, they could be forgiven for thinking that we are merely fiddling while Rome burns. There are, however, some important points to be made, and I'll take a few moments to highlight some of them. I, first of all, and foremost to my constituents, I want to say that I am sorry because of the failure of this Assembly to function properly, that they are being asked to go to the polls again. I deeply regret that and can only apologise to them. It is not what I want, nor I suspect is what most of the members in this House want. Nevertheless, we are where we are. The parties that have brought this motion will no doubt see today as an opportunity for self-congratulation at the collapse of the institutions under the weight of their own strategic and well-thought-out opposition, but I would caution against that. They have individually and collectively failed to lay a glove on either my party or Sinn Féin. Rather, they have relied on the media to perform the function of opposition where they play catch-up. They pause only to check the latest revelation on Twitter before heading off to their respective news outlets. Perhaps they should go into the election asking their voters to vote for some of the journalists who can at least perform the function of scrutiny, which they have singularly failed to do. Oh no, wait. They've already tried running journalists with little or no electoral success. However, I probably shouldn't be too hard on the UUP or the SDLP. Like my party, they too have suffered at the hands of the Sinn Féin strategy. They are pale imitations of their former selves, hollowed out and rattling around the corridors like political Miss Havishams, both desperately seeking to be relevant but finding themselves rejected time after time by the electorate because people know that they are no more able to deliver change now than they ever were when they were in government themselves. Mr. Deputy Speaker, this is not the first time this Assembly has collapsed in crisis. Over the years it has collapsed, been suspended, been reviewed, and it remains to be seen if it can be returned. And throughout all these failures, there's actually one thing in common to all of them, the role of Sinn Féin. Ask the SDLP what it felt like to be eaten alive by a party they brought in from the cold. Ask the Ulster Unionists what it felt like to be on the wrong end of a spying ring run by their then partners in government. It seems to be the case that it doesn't actually matter who's in government. If Sinn Féin aren't getting what they want, then we have to have a crisis. It doesn't matter if it's a mandatory coalition, a voluntary coalition. If Sinn Féin are involved, we are all subject to Gerry's latest plan, and there is nowhere to go if you won't play ball. At the Felons Club a few weeks ago, and we're fortunate that the cameras were there to record it, as Gerry has probably forgotten he was ever at the Felons Club by now, Gerry Adams demanded that Arlene Foster did what society demanded of her. Let's just let that sink in for a moment. Gerry Adams seeing himself as the reasoned voice of society. It's a bit like getting childcare advice from Jimmy Savile. I didn't hear Gerry asking for society's approval when he was shielding paedophiles, rapists and murderers, and that's long after the Good Friday Agreement was signed. I didn't hear him, or Conor Murphy for that matter, ask the Republican killers of Paul Quinn and Robert McCartney hand themselves to the police because society demands they do the right thing. There was no equality or rights or justice for Paul, Robert, nor any other post-agreement victim. No, you see, that's the problem. It's one rule for Sinn Féin and a different one for everyone else. No equality or justice if you're raped by an IRA man, and no need to worry about rights or justice if you're a victim of someone acting under instruction from the Army Council. But stand up for what you believe in politically and challenge that particular status quo. Well, that's not at all acceptable to Gerry. He doesn't like that very much at all. Well, sorry, Gerry. We are not all fatherless children, and we don't need you to break us anymore. We've had quite enough of your egomania for one lifetime. Mr. Deputy Speaker, it has, in the last few days, been pointed out to us repeatedly how much we must change in order to be acceptable to Sinn Féin. And as we head to the polls, I will be listening to my electorate, not Sinn Féin. I bitterly regret the mess of RHI and the effect it has had on the public purse and on public confidence in this place. But perhaps it's a wake-up call that we all need in terms of putting public services first and repaying the faith of those who have sent us here. However, one thing I am confident of is that when it comes to defining what is right, truth and just, I am much more content with Arlene Foster's definition than I ever will be of Gerry Adams. Thank you.
I call Sandra Overend.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and it gives me no pleasure to rise today to outline the failures of this executive. Clearly, the parties of the executive are in election mode now. Only a few weeks ago, the DUP and Sinn Féin were representing each other in TV studios, and now they have to have the two on the radio, and they are now pillars apart. It's easy to sit back and complain about the situation and the fact that we are now returning to the polls, but this motion was laid before the election was called. And it's easy to refer to the failures of the executive that has been in place since May last year. As education spokesperson for the Ulster Unionist Party, it would be remiss of me not to begin with the complete failure of the executive and the education minister to deliver for our young people and to deal with the long-standing issues faced by the Department of Education, the Education Authority, and most importantly, the frontline services we all rely on, our schools, our youth services, and childcare. The failure to find a resolution to the long-standing dispute over teachers' pay, the failure to confirm three-year budgets, the failure to deliver a childcare strategy, the failure to deliver an integrated campus at Struil within budget, failure to conclusively deal with the issue of post-primary transfer, failure to spend the $50 million allocated for capital projects this year under the Fresh Start Agreement, and an ongoing inability to deal with and a complete failure to agree on a sustainable way forward for education in Northern Ireland. Instead, with the looming threat of the area planning process, the Minister and his executive colleagues are looking to frontline services like schools to find the savings. The impact of these failures has been shown most recently in proposals from the Education Authority to close a number of outdoor educational centres across Northern Ireland. Further proposals were recently leaked from the Education Authority, where they are now looking to make cuts to school transport. What other leaks will there be over coming months? Will music lessons in schools be next for the chop, or some other well-used service? Furthermore, it is no secret that the Education Authority is being used as a vehicle to avoid responsibility for decisions to initiate cuts and to be the front man for controversial proposals. We have heard the Minister on numerous occasions utter the phrase, "These are not my proposals," but the Minister must take responsibility for proposals along with any final decisions made on these matters. The DUP Education Minister's complete inaction has left schools and other services provided and funded by his department in an extremely precarious and tentative state. By this stage, much more should have been achieved by the Minister, and indeed none of these are rocket science. They are basic functions of government. In my view, the overarching failure of successive education ministers has been the inability to agree on a joint strategy for education in Northern Ireland. All we have seen is a continuation of pet projects and schemes. No amount of these schemes and projects will ever solve the crisis in our education system. Instead, they will ensure its perpetuation. We need an executive that will tackle these issues head on for the benefit of everyone in Northern Ireland. Of course, an even more immediate failure of the executive has to be the frightening situation in our health service. The scale of the current crisis engulfing our health service is completely unprecedented. The fact that as we...
Thank you for giving way. Would you agree with me that the real outworking of this failed executive can be seen in the faces of 3,400 people who have to avail of food banks in the last 12 months in Lurgan and Portadown, and the 5,200 people who do not have a GP also in Portadown?
Members, next minute.
Thank you, and I thank the member for his intervention. And indeed, yes, it's an ongoing concern right across Northern Ireland, and not just over Van, but thank you. The fact that, as we stand here today, there are 250,000 outpatients waiting on an appointment is shocking. But worse still is the fact that the number of those waiting longer than 52 weeks has jumped from 20,000 to 40,000 over the last year. And there are many tens of thousands more inpatients waiting for day treatment, as well as key diagnostic tests. And these are real people we're talking about here, Mr. Speaker. People with real lives, real jobs and families, and who are being forced to wait disgraceful lengths of time to be seen or to receive treatment. Whilst some may not like my choice of words, we must remember it is a criminal offence to allow animals to suffer. But yet this executive has willfully sat back and allowed people to dwell in pain on waiting lists. I've had countless constituents tell me that they have gone back to their GPs in desperation. They are simply prescribed further pain medication. It is a sad and damning indictment on this ongoing executive that in 2017 that so many people, the NHS, the most cherished of public services, is now tolerating pain rather than treating it. And whilst it would be easy to look at waiting lists...
Ask the member to draw remarks to a close, please.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. There are so many issues that I could continue to raise here, and as I said at the beginning, it gives me no pleasure to see this failing executive. The people of Northern Ireland deserve better.
I call Philip Logan.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Like my colleague Pam Cameron, I also find this a situation of deep regret, and it is of deep regret that I need to address the motion here today. Just 8 months ago in this chamber, shortly after being elected, I gave my maiden speech. I talked about the programme for government. I focused in that speech about delivery, my commitment to delivery, my party's commitment to delivery, my focus on my constituency and my passion for delivering for them. And my party's commitment to Northern Ireland, my commitment to my people in North Antrim still remains, and I'm still as passionate today about that as I was then. And I'm absolutely committed and sure that we need an executive. And as Christopher Stalford rightly set out, we need devolution in Northern Ireland. Be in no doubt here today that this situation we are in has impact. It has impact for the communities in which we represent, the people, the businesses and the organisations. And those are the very same people that we are here to support and to protect. This is a very regrettable situation. But of course, Mr Deputy Speaker and members present, this is not a situation of our making. Be very clear on that. Let me remind you, and let me remind all in this House today, why Sinn Féin have pulled the plug. No, if you listen, you will. I'll help you to understand. In May of 2016, the Nationalist vote fell to the lowest level in 20 years. What we have here is Sinn Féin attempting a rerun of May. Backing up, and that reduced in vote, backs up what we've been saying, that unionism is strong. This party has been saying that for a long time. With DUP at the helm, unionism is strong and our relationship within the United Kingdom is strong and secure. Happy to give way.
Can the member say at all that there is a very definite difference between strength and arrogance? And perhaps it is the arrogance of the DUP has helped to bring us to this political precipice that we're all now lamenting.
Yeah. Members, next a minute.
Thank you. I think the member doesn't understand the difference between arrogance and strength. This party is strong. We have shown that for years. And as a result, we are stronger within the union today than we have been for a long time. And we will not apologise for that. So yes, this situation is regrettable and it's not of our making. Sinn Féin pulled the plug because they were unhappy in May. They're unhappy because of the European referendum result. And this is just attempts to try and backtrack on those things. You know, the Republican agenda has failed. The field, and we heard earlier on, said the field when they were on a terrorist campaign here in Northern Ireland in search of a united Ireland. Then they entered politics, realising that field, giving up the battle with guns and bombs to enter a political battle. And again, a united Ireland is further away than ever. Sinn Féin have tried to mask the issue behind RHI, and they're no strangers to masks. The mask has slipped in many times since last Monday. And just on Monday of last week, Barry McElduff, the member for West Tyrone, summed up Sinn Féin's actions, and this is to try and paint a picture of the situation we're in. The tweet said, "We fight for equality, we fight for respect and for a united Ireland. That is why my comrade is resigning as Deputy First Minister this very day." The mask slipped. There's the evidence. And read Martin McGuinness' resignation letter. The evidence is there. This is masked. Behind RHI. We in these benches don't dance to the tune of Sinn Féin. It is regrettable that some unionists did fall for their trap and demanded Arlene Foster step aside without a shred of evidence against her. They jumped on the Get Foster campaign very quickly. And of course, these are the same unionists who apologised to Sinn Féin for the national anthem, so we in these benches are certainly not surprised. Sinn Féin talk about equality, and we know what equality means. Gerry Adams gave us his definition of equality when he said equality is the Trojan horse of the entire Republican agenda. This is how we will break the... And we all know what Gerry Adams said. The real devastating consequences of Sinn Féin's self-interested moves are the many services that will be affected, either due to a lack of budget or a lack of government to help set direction. This situation has destroyed any hope of agreeing a budget for the next financial year. Without a budget or minister, civil servants will take control of the purse strings, and that would be limiting on what they can spend. David Stirling said, the permanent secretary, said a long period without a government would be very difficult for us to manage. I've already given way, and I really need to get this through here. Our objective as civil servants would be to ensure minimal disruption, but I wouldn't want to downplay the difficulties. And he goes on, and I don't have time. Just last week, I met with the school principals in the Ballymena area. These leaders of education brought me real issues that we need to address. And I would congratulate the Minister, Peter Weir, on the progress that he's made, and so did those principals. But there's still much, much more to do. Further to this, I am disappointed that we have a young generation, a generation of young people, watching this and watching Sinn Féin's actions, who will look at this situation and learn a lesson that when you don't get things your own way, when you get things tough, you just throw in the towel and abandon ship. That is an absolutely shocking example, and that's not something that this party will do. I am gravely concerned and absolutely exasperated. I want to help people. That's why I get into politics. That's why I ran in 2016, to help people and to make their lives better.
Close, please.
And Sinn Féin have made this so much more difficult to do. Thank you, Deputy Speaker.
Éireann Sir Colin McGrath. I call Colin McGrath.
Thank you very much, Mr Deputy Speaker. And I rise here today to support this motion about the failures of this executive. And to begin, I feel that it is important to mention that I believe that the greatest failure of this executive has been the monumental and overwhelming way in which it has attempted and succeeded in places to polarise our politics, sectarianise our institutions, and the gross way that it has let down the views, aspirations and the wishes of the people of Northern Ireland. We have seen year-on-year reductions in the numbers of people turning out to vote, and even bigger numbers of people switching off from politics. And we must, in this House, ask ourselves the question, why is this happening? What is occurring? What is taking place? And what is turning people off politics? Well, Mr. Deputy Speaker, it's RHI, it's NAMA, it's Red Sky, it's Research Services Ireland, it's SIFT funding, it's Charter NI. The list goes on and on, scandal after scandal. This executive, working as it has for so many years in a silo mentality, has let loose ministers that have often had the mist of party politics blinkering their views rather than the good of the community that they serve. We have seen most acutely in the present executive how divisive, ineffective, solo-run ministers running party agendas have brought to its knees and as a result of their crass, selfish mentality. And whilst this behaviour affects politics generally across our country and belittles and demeans our institutions here in Stormont, the impact of this problem can end up lying much more locally. I can think, Mr. Deputy Speaker, of my own constituency and how it has been badly let down. The failure of this executive to deliver appropriate, sustainable health services at the Down Hospital is almost a scandal in its own right and is a prime example. A £64 million built new hospital that had wards closed before its official opening day. With all the pressures that we face in accident and emergency units, we have a newly built unit in the Down Hospital downgraded year after year to its now part-time status and just about a minor injuries unit at the weekend. And whilst we might hear of recruitment problems, financial pressures and service delivery burdens, the failure of this executive is that it hasn't worked collectively to try and fix the problem. Did Detty Department or a new Department of Economy attempt to try and assist with new university places? Did our employment services look to overseas recruitments? Did our infrastructure department even try and provide a direct bus service between two hospitals whenever the consultants refused to leave their ivory tower hospitals and go out into the sticks? How much is left to small units within big silo departments left to sort it out, and when they simply fail, they decry it was too tough a job to do on their own? Then I look at the main street of Downpatrick as a further example, Mr. Deputy Speaker. For years it has been neglected by this executive. We have had the heart ripped out of our town centre like many others, but this executive needed to respond by having joined up working. The Department of Economy delivering economic drivers of initiatives to help new starts and to specialise on focus on products. Our finance department to look at new tax regimes and develop business improvement initiatives. Our communities department to direct and steer local councils to work on the ground to upgrade our town centres. Our infrastructure department to monitor access to town centres and to breathe new life into the way that people can get into them. When I think of Market Street and Downpatrick, I realise that virtually every government department has its say and its work to do. But now have we had joined up forward thinking an innovative executive required to do this work? Have we had that? Not on your Nelly. We have had bluster, argument, bickering, petty cheap point scoring, sectarian-based silo mentality, party political inactivity that has left the people of Northern Ireland wanting. It has left communities with their hearts ripped out and a public service delivered to an all-time low standard matched only by the low level of faith that our electorate have in the institutions. To have in and around the place less than 50% of people of the electorate turning up for an election is an indictment of the inactivity.
Please.
I believe that the executive is not working for the people of Northern Ireland. It has failed them, it has let them down, and the time has come, Mr. Deputy Speaker, for change in Northern Ireland for the good of people.
I call Roy Beggs.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, I too rise to support the motion and the amendment. The fundamental role of any government, and indeed in Northern Ireland the executive, is to take decisions which will improve the lives of the people of Northern Ireland. So how has this DUP Sinn Féin executive fared with regards to the key aspects of any new government, namely the programme for government, the legislative programme and the budget? For each of these critical issues, there has been no output. First, the programme for government. The consultation for a programme for government outcome frames work was about motherhood and apple pie. We want to enjoy healthy, active lives. We want more people working in better jobs. We want to have a safer, to have a safe community where we respect the law and each other. What are the actions? We haven't heard what are the actions that are going to deliver any of this, just nice words. And again, it hasn't been finalised. After 8 months being elected, there is not an agreed programme for government. What an indictment of those who lead this executive. Similarly, any government, if it's to bring about change, requires to improve the law of the land. So where's the legislative programme? Again, this functional DUP Sinn Féin, OFM-DFM-led government, who have been in power for 8 months, have failed to produce a legislative programme. Turning now to the critical aspects of any government, how does it prioritise issues in its financial decisions? Where is the budget for 2017-18? Firstly, we were told that the draft budget could not be produced because the Chancellor's spending review was being published in November. The Welsh Government decided to publish their draft budget in advance in October. The Scottish Government published theirs just before Christmas. In Northern Ireland, the draft budget was expected to be published before Christmas, which would leave just a few weeks for public consultation and scrutiny. But even this draft budget has not been agreed by Sinn Féin DUP leadership under OFM-DFM. They cannot work together. Committees have been unable to scrutinise, and indeed, many employees may well have been receiving protective redundancy notices because their employers have no guarantees of funding come the 1st of April. Worse than that, the Sinn Féin Deputy Minister decided irresponsibly to resign without putting the 2017-18 budget in place. The announcement of elections was made yesterday, and emergency measures will kick in, reflecting previous funding. There must be huge uncertainty to vulnerable members of the public, for civil servants delivering public services, and others funded by public funds. Take the issue of health. We've suffered a year of growing waiting lists, and we've been promised this new health reform and new money coming in. What happened to the 2016 synchronised DUP Sinn Féin election promise of an additional £1 billion a year? Where is this additional fund? Where is the budget? It doesn't exist. Where is the great report, the great way forward? It hasn't even been published, and if it's published now, what weight does it have? It does not have any weight because we're going into election and there is no commitment behind it thereafter. Then there's the issue of the regional rate, which cannot be set because of the absence of the budget. Without an agreed regional rate, the rate bills can't be sent out, but they still will have to be paid. We all will still have to pay. Monthly direct debits cannot be collected. Local government will suffer cash flow. Finally, there is the failure of this executive to adopt agreed actions to protect the interests of Northern Ireland following the EU referendum decision for the UK to leave the European Union. There is great uncertainty out there, particularly within the business community, as to how we will be or they will be able to trade within the European Union partners. I would commend the Northern Ireland food and drinks industry for their report, their Brexit report, which has concisely highlighted some of the great challenges facing Northern Ireland. They indicate that the average profit in their companies is 2.94%, but a hard Brexit would result in food tariffs of between 7 and 65%.
The member to draw his remarks to
so we have £1.3 billion of food products, 28% of our production, at risk. What would happen? We must make sure there is coherent government giving direction, looking after the interests of the people of Northern Ireland, instead of this irresponsible lot we have at the minute. Thank you.
I call Joanne Dobson.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and I take no pleasure in speaking on this motion today, but I do so as the Ulster Unionist Party health spokesperson and wish to focus my comments on, as the motion says, the grave consequences for the health of our people in Northern Ireland. It's frankly outrageous that one in five of our population are trapped on a hospital waiting list. But even more outrageous that we were told last year we would have to wait until January to hear the Minister's comprehensive plan. Shocking that there wasn't a plan already in place. However, it is most shocking that if the Minister releases it, it will be a Sinn Féin press release, paper thin, with no money or resources behind it. No prospect of making any real and meaningful difference to our constituents because of the lack of the agreed budget. Shameful, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I also want to turn my comments to the present GP crisis and pay tribute to the work of GP representatives. A rescue plan is needed and sadly isn't likely to come forward anytime soon. Shameful. What is also shameful is the actions of the Department of Health and the Health and Social Care Board around the GP cover for the patients of Banview Practice in Portadown, an issue in which my colleague Doug Beattie and I have been working tirelessly, and the latest twist of which was a new contractor withdrew yesterday, days after they were appointed. Indeed, the Board and the Minister told us they had been secured. That's why, Mr. Deputy Speaker, I tabled an urgent oral question this afternoon to the Minister of Health. And it's abundantly clear that the actions have failed the people of Portadown, and it's a clear and painful example, as the motion states, of how this executive, in this instance through the Health Minister, is failing to safeguard the interests of the people of Northern Ireland. The GP crisis, as we know, threatens cover across Northern Ireland, and that became abundantly clear by the speakers who wanted to take part this afternoon. And with hundreds of GPs considering resigning, that rescue package can no longer become a reality. Mr. Deputy Speaker, this is what happens when politics gets in the way of progress, when the political soap opera overtakes the practical job of actually working hard for our constituents. It is abundantly clear that the health service, and more importantly, the health of the people of Northern Ireland, become the main casualty of this political crisis. I said I take no pleasure in speaking on this motion. I urge an urgent resolution to the crisis at the Banview practice and open and frank negotiations with GPs and their representatives before it's too late. I fear, however, Mr. Deputy Speaker, that that time has already passed.
I call Stephen Agnew.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Over the Christmas recess, I was contacted by the chief executive of a charity. They're Belfast-based. They have a project working with vulnerable families, supposed to be called an early intervention project. They're waiting to hear whether or not they'll get their extended year funding that they were anticipating. But because there's been no budget, no likelihood of a budget, it's unlikely that they will hear. As a result of that, 45 staff have had to be put on notice, and 700 service users will be let down. And that's just one example of the many services that are under threat due to the failure of this executive. The traditional parties have wasted their opportunity to provide stable government in Northern Ireland, and I think the failure to produce a budget is the most damning, given its consequences. Even if Mr. Alistair's wrong and the civil service can implement 75% of the budget, it's still going to be huge cuts to our public services, and it is often those in the community and voluntary sector that are the first to lose out. Now, Sinn Féin, I think, have quite rightly pointed to the DUP and Arlene Foster in particular and said, you need to hold your hands up. You need to be accountable for the RHI fiasco. I think that's right. But much was made of the so-called Braves decision of Sinn Féin to take the finance portfolio. And they have a duty to produce a budget. The finance minister, who should be here today to hear this debate, has a responsibility to explain to the people of Northern Ireland why we head into an election with the possibility of no agreed budget at the other side in advance of the March 31st deadline. This is the fundamental of government providing services, and yes, we would have had a debate in here about the budget. No doubt I would have been unhappy with it, as is my wont. But producing a budget is the minimum that we should expect. And anyone who is derelict in that duty is unfit for government, quite frankly. So I'm clear that I don't like the situation we're in. I don't like that we're heading to an election. I don't believe it should have come to this. But I am pleased that the electorate will have the opportunity to give their verdict on these failures. Because for all the debates we've had in this chamber, all the disagreements we've had, I do think this has been the most startling failure that we have seen. So I will be pleased to offer a positive alternative, that the Green Party will be out as a progressive party, offering our alternative to what we've seen. And I will take the opportunity to highlight the waste of this executive, whether it be the waste of money of the RHI or the waste of opportunity to reform Northern Ireland for the better. I hate where we've got to. I hate that our people have been failed in such a way. Job losses are inevitable. Over a political fallout that could and should have been resolved, Arlene Foster should have done what I believe to be the honourable thing and stepped aside, but Martine O'Muller should have presented a budget to us on the 19th of December, as was anticipated. Mr. Deputy Speaker, as we know, we're heading into an election and the electorate will make their judgment on that.
I call Eamon McCall.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Pretty strange atmosphere around this place today, I found, since I came in this morning. You wouldn't know what to make of it, Mr. Deputy Speaker. We're debating if Sinn Féin's name's mentioned, because up all the time, their benches are empty, there's hardly anybody on the DUP benches. Here we are, it's like we're talking in a vacuum. It's I suppose this is the way the Assembly ends. You know, not with a bang, but with a sort of whimpering diminuendo of interest, or if I'll be slink away. So what, achieving what, having achieved what? Absolutely nothing. Certainly in terms of the big issues which I confront us in the interests of the majority of the people. I mean, but I came in sort of about an hour ago or so, I discovered Mr. Logan, I'm terribly sorry I've forgotten his name for a minute. As I came in, the ferocious attack which was coming from Mr. Logan on Sinn Féin. I mean, it really took me way back to the 1950s. I can go back that far. You know, sort of. I really sort of. The poisonous nature of these people. And by God, did you see this tweet that demonstrates that they're out for a United Ireland? Nothing less. Now, there's a revelation. That was part of the year 2017. It was old-fashioned stuff. You know, Mr. Logan, appears to be a lively young man, but sir, with a doddery old man's head on his shoulders. This, sir, is a biological impossibility and a social and political undesirability. But it's what we were reduced to by the politics of this place. And that's what I would like to deal with in the couple of minutes left to me. But let me can talk about who's right and who's wrong, and I do it as well, sort of about RHI and all the rest of the things. But many of the problems that we are talking about are actually generated from within the system of governance here in Northern Ireland. They're not really to do, or not entirely to do, certainly with the character or the perspectives of particular parties. And these contradictions have been built from the beginning. The executive has collapsed under the weight of its own contradictions. You can analyse it any way you like, but the contradictions were there, sort of, and the flaws in the system, sort of, were not in the edifice of the executive. The flaws are fundamental. The flaws are in the foundations of the system. Sort of, and that if you believe, as you're invited to believe by our system, that you're going to be judged at the polls. And we're told this all the time. I'm told this all the time by commentators and come quite sharp on the cervix. Commentators, is that the only thing that matters in this country is whether you're green or orange. I heard somebody shouting about Peter Weir, I think it was, from the DUP benches yesterday. Oh, you're a green, sorry, you're not a red at all. It reminded me of, and I don't go back quite this far, sort of, remember a by-election sort of in the 19th century, till the end of the 19th century, in North Belfast. Sort of, was a fellow stood as a Labour candidate. And the Northern Whig newspaper carried an editorial which said, McGrath is a nationalist no matter what he says or thinks. Now, there's no answer to that. You got that sort of. And if you believe sort of that the only measure that you're going to be judged against is how you have served the discrete and specific interests of your particular community, then of course there's no dividend in taking up questions to do with a childcare strategy, for example, which we don't have, or a sexual orientation strategy, once we don't have, because those things do not differentially affect one community from the other. There's no dividend for your tribal chieftains in that sort of thing. And thus, therein lies the connection between the neglect of these issues and all the suffering that follows from the neglect of these issues on the one hand, and the very structures which have been erected on the Good Friday Agreement on the other. Now, we have people before profit believe that it is possible to talk in class terms in this society, and talk about class terms, about things which are normally considered divisive. You know, I mean, how are we going to deal? What's our approach to the murder by British soldiers of Robert Johnson and Robert McKinney? Can we talk about them in the same breath as Bloody Sunday? Mr. Johnson and Mr. McKinney from the Shankill Road, murdered by the Parachute Regiment, two entirely innocent, decent men, shot down and killed in September 1972, not just by the same regiment of the Parachute Regiment, by the same man. I can name them to you. If I have to, I will in this House. Name the same people who went to Glen Fadden Park and the Bogside and murdered people. I have approached unionist representatives of the Shankill Road and say, let's get together and work on this. Let's get the truth for those families. I was told to my face, it would be better if you didn't intervene. You'll only sort of undermine us. Sort of, you'll associate us with people who are against the army and all the rest. There you can see the way in which sectarian mindsets prevent justice being delivered even to the people of the community which purportedly is being served by these people. So we will put a perspective, a class perspective, in front of the people. We'll advocate a trade union freedom bill, which we have already drafted. That's the type of thing which should be put before the people if we're going to give sort of young people sort of some hope for the future. As things are going, it's been possible to say, we're going to weep any bitter tears at the end of this assembly. By God, sort of, we deserve something better, and we'll be in the field offering the people something better. Thanks very much.
I call Carla Lockhart.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker, and can I thank you for giving me the opportunity to speak in this debate. I certainly hadn't planned, and I don't have anything prepared, but I felt it was necessary to get up as an elected representative for the Upper Ban constituency. And I have to say, it's a great pleasure to stand here today and to continue to represent the people that put me here. I have to say that I think it's a very sad day for Northern Ireland. I think it's a very grave day for Northern Ireland. And as I sit and listen to the people in this chamber echoing and howling and growling about the failures of this assembly, I have to say that I believe that's a reflection on them, because as I have been elected for what, over 250 days, I have sought to fight and to deliver for the people of Upper Ban, and that's what I'm here to do. And if they would take a step back and realise that's what they're there to do, and to fight for their constituency. You tell me and tell my constituents, the likes of Brownlow House, that has been able to achieve over £40,000-£50,000 of money and grant funding towards shared education and towards
promoting shared education in Lurgan, a place which has been one of the most polarised towns in this country. You tell Brownlow House that this executive has failed them. You tell Brownlow House that I have failed them, because I don't believe that's right. You tell the people in Upper Ban that have waited for years to have a Minister of Education that had a heart for the Dixon Plan. You tell them that this executive has failed them. Whenever we had a minister that listened to the people of Upper Ban and was willing to go out and to say, do you know what, there's a system that works, why break it, why tear it down? You tell those people that this executive hasn't worked and that I have failed those people, because I don't believe we have. I can go through a litany of things that I have delivered. Millennium Way, a new infrastructure in Lurgan, a new road. 40 years we have waited on it, 40 years, and this executive delivered it. So I welcome that. I welcome that. And you know, those can laugh and you can scorn. And to be quite honest, I don't mind. Laugh away. Because I'm here to represent my people. I have a heart for Upper Ban, and I don't want to see these institutions fall, because I believe that this is what delivers for people on the ground, and that's what I'm prepared to do. That's what I'm elected to do, and I can assure you that's what I stand on going forward, because I believe that I, as an elected representative, am their voice, I am their listening ear, and it is vitally important that I get up every day of the week and represent the people that I have been elected to represent. Absolutely, no problem.
I got involved in politics to represent and fight for the people of East Belfast and indeed all the people of Northern Ireland. Perhaps a member can tell the people, the nearly 40,000 people on the housing waiting list that successive DUP ministers have not delivered for. What do you tell those people who can't get a house, who have to wait and languish in hostels?
Members, an extra minute.
Thank you very much. And can I thank the member for his intervention? I'm not saying we have a perfect world out there. I'm not saying that we have adequate resources to service the needs of everyone. I'm not saying that. But what I'm saying is this was a workable solution that we thought 5 years would certainly have made a change. But unfortunately, there are those who have walked away. And it's those people who should answer your question. Because I'm prepared to stand in this House and to fight for more social housing. I'm prepared to stand and to ensure that the housing list goes down in terms of the number of people working, looking for houses. That's what I'm here to do. That's what I'm elected to do, as are you, Mr. Allen. And I don't take that away from anyone. But I say today, it's a stark day that we have had a party that has walked away from their electorate. Because believe it or not, their electorate needs are exactly the same as my electorate needs. And that's the harsh reality. We sit here today with electorate that need good health care, we need good education, we need a functioning executive that delivers for them. And unfortunately, there are those who have taken that decision to walk away. And I trust that people scratch the surface, look beneath the surface, and realise that is why that those who have walked away are to blame for this mess. Certainly.
Can I thank the member for giving way? And I have no doubt at all about your passion for the people that you represent, and it's been evident on multiple occasions in this chamber. But do you recognise that we are in a very difficult position because of political failures? And yes, Sinn Féin, who are absent today and have been absent on so many issues, are to blame. But do you accept that the DUP plays some part in being responsible for where we are today at this very stark and dark moment?
I thank the member for her intervention, and I commend her, because I do believe you're a passionate politician, and I can see that as well. I believe no party and no person is above doing something wrong or making a mistake. I am sure we all stand here today as elected representatives. So certainly all I can say is we as a party have sought to deliver for the people that we represent, and I believe we will go out to the constituents and we will sell the delivery, because that's what has happened.
I call Jim Allister.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. It's no surprise to me that mandatory coalition has imploded. It was bound to happen because it is a system incapable of long-term survival. And of course it has imploded because at its heart was a party that never really cared whether good government was brought to Northern Ireland or not. Indeed, one of the searching questions that all Democrats, and particularly unionists, have to now ask themselves is whether or not Sinn Féin ever did intend or ever does intend to help make Northern Ireland work, or whether for them Stormont was only ever a phase in their struggle to in fact destroy Northern Ireland, to extract what you could, and when you could extract no more, to move on in their militaristic terms to the next phase of the struggle. That certainly is my belief. And I believe it is that point that we have reached, that after 10 years of beating what they could out of mandatory coalition and having decided there's nothing more for them, unless someone wants to come and load them up with more concessions, then for them, strategically, they have decided Stormont is over. And the only thing that will bring them back here is if the continuance of Stormont so serves their ends, because the DUP decides after the election, for the sake of office, to fill Sinn Féin's boots with more concessions. Yes, you can have a Stormont under mandatory coalition if you're willing to pay that impossible price. And Sinn Féin is testing you to see just how desperate you are to hang on to power. And of course, if you pay the price again, you will pay it again and again and again. Yes, I'll give away.
Indicate what concessions the present First Minister has made to Sinn Féin in this last 12 months.
The DUP made the most colossal concession that we would abandon the fundamental principle of democracy, that who's in government lies in the discretion of the people, and we would bestow that discretion on the parties. Because that is the essence of mandatory coalition. Any other democracy, the people have the discretion to decide who's in and who's out. They can decide to vote a party out of government. That's in their discretion. But because of the iniquity of mandatory coalition, that discretion is removed from the voters and bestowed upon the parties. Once you create a system which says you are entitled as of right, provided you've got a handful of MLAs, you're entitled as of right to be in government, then you transfer the discretion, which is the heart of democracy, as to who should be in government from people to parties. And that is the fundamental flaw of mandatory coalition. And when in the doing of that, you bestow that discretion on a party which doesn't even want the country of which they're governing to exist or to succeed, then it's quite clear. I would have thought that's a system bound to implode when it has served its purpose for those prepared to use it and exhaust its credit. And that's the point we've reached at. Reached. And unless we get to a system of voluntary coalition, government by the willing, then we're not ever going to have a durable, lasting devolution. And that reality needs to be faced. And if this House and the parties in this House are not mature enough to come to the point of voluntary coalition, then we are headed to direct rule. And what needs to happen then is that British ministers need to take over the executive. But this time, direct rule can be made accountable by keeping this House as the law-making body, so that Westminster's ministers have to put their laws through this House on devolved issues and are held to account through the scrutiny of this House. This Assembly has three functions. Two of them have worked reasonably well. One's the lawmaking, one's the scrutiny. They've worked reasonably well. The one that has been catastrophic is the executive powers. So if the executive powers are the failure and you can't agree voluntary coalition, then take them out, put in British ministers, and make direct rule accountable to the people by retaining the Assembly for the legislative and scrutiny functions. That's the only way that I believe we can make progress, because it's quite clear that if we've given a veto to Sinn Féin, a party that wants to destroy Northern Ireland through mandatory coalition, they're going to do exactly that.
I now call Paula Bradshaw to wind on the amendment, and you have up to 5 minutes.
Thank you very much, Mr Deputy Speaker. I rise to support the motion and to wind on our amendment. Unfortunately, very few people actually referenced the amendment, which related to the regional rates, but it's totally understandable on a day like today. I was in a near-empty chamber like this yesterday evening when we were discussing around collaboration from the Health Department and Justice Department around alcohol-related crime. And like today, it was very lamentable that Sinn Féin MLAs absented themselves from that debate. Does Sinn Féin MLAs not think that these matters, like this issue today, matters to their constituents? So I think it's very shameful that they've decided to walk away. This is a very important motion, and I applaud the opposition parties for bringing it today. Again, I think it would have been far better served if we had debated this 4 or 5 months ago, because it was very clear to many of us sitting here in the back benches that the wheels were starting to come off the executive months ago. And I think that we can trace it really back to the day after the referendum result on Brexit. What we were promised whenever Arlene Foster came in to post as the First Minister again last May, June, was that we would have a stable, united executive. And I think that the MLAs who are present here today, with some exceptions possibly, and the wider public will be feeling very let down now over the news in the last 24 hours that we're now heading for an election. I'm going to concentrate really on the implications of this failure of the executive to bring forward a budget in a health sphere. And we mentioned it earlier whenever the Health Minister came to the House to answer the urgent oral from my colleague Mrs Dobson around the crisis in the GP sector. We as the Health Committee were very supportive of the Health Minister when she brought forward her roadmap, as she calls it, for delivering on health and wealth, health transformation. And within that, there were very sensible proposals that had been brought forward by the Bengoa report. To deliver on that, she was required, and she said that she had executive approval for additional investment. And the investment would be to allow for what's called, what she again called, double running, which meant existing services would go on while bringing in new services, innovative practices, and roll out best practice pilots that have been introduced in one trust area into the other. Without the budget and without that extra investment, it will be a long time until we see these necessary changes. And again, the banned few practice is a clear example of why the Minister and the Executive should be up and running to deliver on that, as opposed to this needless election. Also in relation to the health and social care sector, we were promised this new programme for government, the new approach around outcomes-based accountability. And coming from the community sector, I was very aware that this was stuff that was rolling on behind the scenes. And over the last few months, community groups, health charities, voluntary organisations brought together groups of their users, their members, their board directors, to discuss in as much detail as possible their response to the consultation consultation process for the programme for government. They too should be feeling very let down today. Where is that programme for government now? It's in the gutter. And I think that it's going to be very difficult for those groups at the far side of the election to get any enthusiasm up to come forward and bring together people, again, health charities, bringing people, like I know Parkinson's UK brought people out of their homes to consult on this. Shame on the executive for not being able to deliver through on this programme for government. My colleague Stephen Farrell earlier on mentioned about the regional rate, so I'll not go into this, but one final point I will make around the catastrophic failure of this executive was the fact that there's no plan for Brexit. And shame again on the DUP for promoting the exit to their electorate and to their voters. We have no idea the extent to which we will be disadvantaged from coming out of Europe. We already know that hundreds of millions of pounds of grants for research will not be coming forward. We are already being excluded from research trials, health trials. And how expensive is it going to be for...
Member to draw remarks to a close, please.
How expensive is it going to be for the UK to buy into those drugs and those new procedures when we're outside Europe? So I commend the amendment to the House, and I would seek the support of those people present today, those who bothered to turn up.
I call Claire Hannah, Éireann Sir Claire Hannah, to wind on the debate.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and thank all those members who've contributed to this debate, which has been a retelling of the very sad life story of this failed government. Mike Nesbitt opened up the debate with a lengthy blooper reel of some of the failings of the DUP and Sinn Féin over the last decade. He spoke about the survivors of institutional abuse, who I know are here today, and that's an issue that has a lot of resonance with me, because it was 9.5 years ago that my mum, who served in this Assembly, brought that motion after campaigning for a number of years, and 9.5 long years have elapsed before those victims have had the support and the redress that they need. And the absent Finance Minister spoke very eloquently yesterday about the experiences of some of those people. But what he failed to mention, that not only is there no budget being brought forward to give them redress, they were not mentioned, and their case and their cause and their sorrows were not mentioned in the programme for government that was being lauded just 3 weeks ago. The same goes for issues like equal marriage and an Irish Language Act and others that are being made election issues that were totally overlooked in the strategic plan that was to set the stage for this mandate. I think this is disingenuous in the extreme, and it is part of the package of spins that is coming out in the dog days of this executive, like enhanced rail services for Newry and like breastfeeding legislation that nobody's going to be here to legislate. And I'm not one for quoting Donald Trump, but I will say you are fake news, because they're putting out things that do not exist. Mr. Nesbitt covered many other issues as well, including the failure to deliver a victim's pension to 400 people who had their life opportunities taken away from them in these troubles. And we all attend a lot of meetings, and I must say I have met with that group two or three times, and I am mortified to sit through. I'm mortified to be part of an Assembly that has made promises to those people and has failed to deliver, to give them the small comfort of a small pension for many of them in the latter years of their lives as well. He also highlighted the irony that one of the DUP's last acts in this chamber will have been their petition of concern applied yesterday to the motion on the Speaker, which I think is characteristic of their approach to accountability. Stephen Farry highlighted the missed opportunity that we have had in the governance of this Assembly, and I think he's had, certainly our view, that the trust that was supposed to build up through power sharing, through parties working together in common endeavour, which was the very ethos of the Good Friday Agreement, has been brushed aside by parties who share power because the law tells them they have to share power, and not because they want to or because they believe it's for the advancement of people here. Dr. Farry also highlighted the cronyism and the deadlock and the lack of transparency that has characterised this government. Christopher Stalford, with a remarkable grasp of the obvious, pointed out that Northern Ireland is safer now than it used to be, and in doing so inadvertently highlighted how the Ulster Unionists in fact did much of the heavy lifting to create the framework that has brought us to this place. And we agree entirely that Sinn Féin share a lot of blame for this car crash that we're in now, but DUP speaker after speaker clearly failed to grasp the joint nature of both the institutions and the mess that they're experiencing now. Colm Eastwood pointed out probably one of the most visible signs here and now of the failure, and that the benches to our right are empty. He recounted the hollowness of the programme for government and the unwillingness of the DUP and Sinn Féin to engage in the development of it during the negotiations last May. And Hannah highlighted the hypocrisy of Sinn Féin's simultaneous attack on the opposition parties for leaving government while they're in the middle of leaving government. He highlights the paucity of the executive's response to Brexit, because the fresh start was the end of history, and anything that happened afterwards, including the biggest political and economic crisis that we're going to experience, has to play second fiddle to their own selfish squabbles and interests. And Roy Begg's return to this fundamental issue, which was highlighted today by Theresa May's highlighting of plans that she's received from other devolved assemblies. I didn't have great expectations about any DUP speeches, but to be compared to Miss Havisham's by Pam Cameron really took the biscuit. The hubris on display by the DUP speakers, and by the way, I don't doubt the commitment of the individuals who spoke to fighting for their constituents, but they need to understand that the behaviour of their party has taken that opportunity away from all of us to fight for our constituents. And I think talking about protecting and continuously protecting the DUP voters' interests, again, entirely misses the point. As the DUP did with Brexit, there are more people out there than just DUP voters. You said that nobody had laid a glove on you politically. I think we'll see whether or not the electorate wants to lay a glove on you too, because the electorate as well would rather see £500 million in public services than £500 million going up in smoke. Sandra Overend raised the failure to resolve the post-primary mess, and I think that is one of the starkest failures, where 10 years of 10 and 11-year-olds have to pay the price for political inertia and failure to get round and resolve a problem. Colin McGrath and Joanne Dobson gave magnificent defences of the health service, which has experienced 10 years of strategies that are never followed through, and which is now facing the winter crisis and the year ahead without a budget in place. Stephen Agnew reminded us that no matter how poor the budget was likely to be, and he pointed out that the last few have lacked imagination and fairness, the inability of the executive to even put a budget before us last month and this month demonstrates complete unfitness for office, and that the failure, the wrong of the finance minister's dereliction and the wrong of Arlene Foster's arrogance certainly don't make a right. Eamon McCann laid bare the binary worldview of the DUP and Sinn Féin, and how common goods like a childcare strategy and like a sexual orientation strategy will always play second fiddle to the efforts that we've seen over the last few years to just get one over on each other and one up for their voter base. Jim Allister questioned whether or not Sinn Féin were committed to making Northern Ireland work at all. Paula Bradshaw made the excellent point about the hopes and the effort of voluntary sector groups who took the time in the days before Christmas for many of them to respond in good faith to a programme for government that is now going to sit on a shelf forever, and that it will diminish the interest and the possibility of civil society groups in particular engaging with future programme for governments. And I feel it is part of a war of attrition by those parties who know that they can wear down and wreck the heads of moderate centre-ground people here, and then use dog whistles to get their own voters out at the end. She also raised Alliance's amendment on rates, which we are content to add to the very long list of governance failings. I will add to that list, and to recap, it includes leaving us exposed to the worst aspects of a hard Brexit, led by a government who have no interest and no understanding of the needs of people in Northern Ireland. It also includes failures to bring forward strategies or legislation to advance the rights of ethnic minorities and the LGBT community. It includes less childcare support than the Conservatives can provide for working families across the water. But what it does include, apparently, is very large bonuses in terms of the NAMA portfolio. It includes furlough job for paramilitary bosses. So I think, members, it's sad that people, that half of the executive haven't bothered to turn up, but I think it has been very clear. This has been 10 years wasted, 10 years that Northern Ireland could have progressed, 10 years that Northern Ireland could have prepared itself to weather the difficulties in global politics at the moment. That opportunity has been wasted by this executive. And while none of us doubt that we were in a better place than we were during the Troubles, I agree with Mr. Stalford on that. It's sad to see that wasted, and I think we must all send out the message to a brow-beaten public that there are alternatives to this, that if you want the same level of dysfunction, then do stay at home or do vote the way you've always voted before, but there are opportunities for change.
Okay, members, the question is that the amendment standing on the marshalled list be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. I think if there's an urgency that we go to a vote here, we clear the lobbies. Clear the lobbies. The question will be put in 3 minutes. Members will resume their seats, please. Members, order. The question is that the amendment standing on the marshalled list be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
Right. Do we have tellers? Order, members. Tellers have been appointed as follows. Tellers for the ayes are Stuart Dixon and Paula Bradshaw. Tellers for the noes are Carla Lockhart and George Robinson. Clear the lobbies. The Assembly will divide ayes to my right, noes to my left. Order. Members, resume their seats, please. And clerk, read the result.
63 members voted, 34 members voted aye, 29 members voted no. The amendment is therefore agreed.
The question now is that the motion as amended be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
No. Contrary? The motion is then carried as amended. If members please take their ease now while we move to the next item of business.